Schellenberg und macht Malawi.
Boker Tov, Zoraim Tovim, hi. Good afternoon. It's now definitely afternoon. Yes, good afternoon. We are going to listen today to Miroslav Zafirov on the subject of Iran in Lebanon and in Iraq after 1979, creating Hezbollah, of course, in Lebanon, and struggling with Najaf, and of course the Ayatollahs of Najaf in that period. The contest between Qom and Najaf, you can say, between the two major Shi'i centers, Shi'i learning. No, it's a political sentence. Miroslav Zafirov is a diplomat, senior diplomat. He was born in 1977. He holds degrees in Middle Eastern policy and Hebrew studies. Hebrew studies, I want to make it very clear. He started his career in 2003 at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of the Republic of Bulgaria with a focus on the Gulf, Iraq and Syria. Very topical, you chose so well. How did you know what to choose?
It wasn't on purpose, actually.
It was, okay, it just happened, but very good. Among others, he served as a member of the team of the Middle East and Syrian, for the Middle East, and Syrian crisis of the former Minister of Foreign Affairs, and as chargé d'affaires at the embassy of Bulgaria in Doha. He's just coming back from Doha now, by the way. After 12 years of national service, he assumed the post of political affair officer at the United Nations Assistant Missions, Iraq, UNAMI, in 2014. Currently, since recently, he is part of the team of the United Nations Special Coordinator for the Middle East and Peace Process. And as I understand it, you are traveling from Jerusalem to Gaza quite often.
Yeah. And Egypt.
Egypt and, well. And now Doha. He's all over the place. So
that probably would be the topic of your next lecture.
Yeah, well, I'm sure he'll have many lectures. He'll give us many lectures here. We are very lucky and very happy to have Miroslav as our Middle East Department's PhD student, and his tutors are Professor Michael Eppel, Dr. Soli Shahavar, and your humble slave. And now we are all yours, sir.
Thank you very much. It's a great privilege, actually. I would say that. It's been a while after we were discussing the possibility of having this lecture. It's been once, it's been postponed due to unforeseen reasons. But today, I'm very happy to be here, and which lecture meeting coincides with a major assault of the Iraqi security forces towards Fallujah. Whether it will be successful or it won't be successful, it's a different story. We have to be hopeful but not very optimistic. As I was discussing this once with colleagues in London, when they asked me what do you think about Iraq, I said that probably someone has to be a paranoid optimist, because you never know. You really never know what will happen there. Anyhow, I would like to, as an entry point to to my humble speech, honestly speaking, I would like to use the fact and to remind the fact of the beginning of the crisis in Iraq, which has officially, the current crisis in Iraq, which has officially started in the very beginning of June 2014 with the fall of the city of Mosul. which basically opened the doors for the advancement of the Islamic State, which I would prefer to call ISIL, and which fall of Mosul and advancement led to the consequent loss of one third of the territory of a sovereign state of Iraq. And it had, therefore, an immense repercussions across the country. Iraq appeared to be in an institutional collapse, which has been provoked especially by the inability of the army, as well as of the political and community leaders of the country, to react adequately and thus to confront the invaders. As a result of the growing instability and facing the perspective of losing not only of its entire north, Iraq political elite looked at Najaf, and more specifically to the Grand Marshal Ali al-Sistani, Grand Ayatollah, therefore expecting not only advice, which was highly anticipated, but also an assistance. As a result of some coordination, the supreme religious authority, Shia authority, not only in Iraq but across the Islamic world, where we had Shia communities, issued his famous fatwa, which was calling upon the Iraqi nation to stand alongside with its army and defend the country. The reasoning behind the fatwa, which was, I would like to underline the fact, was calling for a jihad al-kifai, it was not a sectarian one, is already largely discussed, as well as the results of its issuance. Whether it has reached its goals is a dispute which continues to engage many people's minds, and even today. But one thing would be rather indisputable, and that should be probably the focus of our meeting of today. The fatwa of Grand Ayatollah Sistani not only legitimized the dormant Shia militias, but it also gave them the legal background to re-emerge, and what is more important, open the way in front of Iran to enter Iraq politically and militarily in a rather unchecked way if we compare to what has happened in 2003. As many people would argue today in Iraq, if in 2003 the invasion, if we can say that, of Iran in Iraq has happened unexpectedly, even for the Iranians, the opportunity to invade has happened unexpectedly for the Iranians. This time, since the fall of the North, Iran appeared to be quite well prepared for the implementation of its strategy. The Iranian assistance, despite all speculations, has played a significant role, and I will even elaborate by saying that in two particular cases the Iranians played a decisive role. Under the pressing advancement of ISIL forces and its Iraqi allies, the fate of Baghdad has been at stake. It was due to the Shia militias and the logistical support of Iran that saved the capital. Later the same year of 2014, on July 31st, ISIL approached the fortification facilities of the Kurdish Peshmergas surrounding the capital of the Kurdish regional region Erbil. After a few days of severe fights, the line of defense has been compromised, which endangered the very security of the region and also seriously questioned the invincibility of the Kurdish military forces. Again, the Iranian interference played an important role. Kurdish forces were timely enforced with deliveries of various kinds coming from Iran. Iranian experts fought with Kurdish alongside with the Kurdish militaries. And later, at the very beginning of August, defensive operation has been additionally enforced by the US Air Force operation, which commenced as a result of the interference of the UN mission in Iraq, therefore to prevent a further extermination of the Yazidi population in the area of Sinjar Mountain. As we remember, technically the United States get involved into the conflict after we saw the outcomes of the ISIL occupation of Sinjar, and which was actually leading to a massive casualties among the Yazidi population. Many would speculate about the genesis of ISIL, yet one thing is pretty certain: it gave an exceptional opportunity to Iran to once again attempt imposing its influence in Iraq, and probably to achieve a decisive and strategic victory over its neighbor, both politically, but what is much more important in my mind, religiously, through putting their hand over Najaf, and therefore completing the long-standing competition for the hearts and minds of the Shia community across the Middle East and further. The competition which today attracts the attention has its roots deeply engraved in the history of interaction between the two major religious centers, Qom and Najaf. The rivalry today is shaped by the position of both centers towards the issue of the Wilayat Faqih, or as it is preferable to be defined in Najaf, and in my meetings there with the officers of the Grand Ayatollahs there, as they are defining it, it's the argument between the Wilayat Amma and Wilayat Hassa. Najaf avoids labeling using the term of Wilayat Faqih. In fact, the intellectual dispute over the wilaya, well disguised, the tense enmity which exists between Iran and Iraqi religious elite. This tension is provoked by the intention of the high Shia religious establishment of both countries to exert a tight and complete control over the Shia communities worldwide. Looking at the dispute from the perspective of Baghdad, it seems that Najaf still leads in this uneasy competition due to its significance as place of martyrdom and burial of Imam Ali. It's been always and remains today the most attractive center, not only from religious point of view, but as well as a center of Shia religious studies. The number of students seeking educational proficiency in Najaf, despite political turbulences, never experienced a decline. Najaf is also an attracting point for substantial financial income. Due to its shrines and the presence of the most learned among the Shias, as they are defined by some scholars, the city accumulates significant assets which are consequently spent through the existing charity networks in various places across the Middle East where Shia communities inhabit. Best example in this regard is the Al-Khoi Foundation, which is established by the late Grand Ayatollah Abul Qasim Al-Khoi and currently is monitored by a board of trustees residing in London. It has its representatives in many places, among which Iran and Pakistan and Afghanistan, and is carefully taking care of the needs of its congregation. The foundation, which is also known among the Iraqi population with the term the Bank of Najaf, exists also as an investment institution, therefore depositing finances in different investment portfolios. Despite certain allegations, as in certain books, like the one of Elvir Korbos, The Guardians of Shiism, the financial, which is mentioning some financial irregularities, the foundation and its allies, which exist currently, are predominantly engaged in spending well the money of the worshippers, therefore protecting the interests of the community. If we have to summarize rivalry between Najaf and Qom, It is related to the influence, both politically and religiously, which raises the issue of the inseparability between clerical and secular power in Islam, and the financial assets. The revolution of 1979 in Iran and its importance for the Middle East is a well-researched topic. Among other issues of interest, though, the relations with Najaf are of no less significance. Reigning in Iran under the principles of the new constitution of 1979, which proclaimed and installed the principles of Wilayat Faqih, Ayatollah Khomeini looked at Iraq, aiming to also test its ability to challenge Najaf. Himself a product of the Najafi school, during his presence in the city, Imam Khomeini benefited from by the intellectual disputes and developed his understanding about the Wilayat Faqih. Taking credit of his studies, Khomeini followed the remarks of Sayyid Abul Hassan al-Isfahani and Mirza Hussein al-Naini, the top two mujtahids at that time, about the essence of the concept of the governance of the Islamic jurists. The comments of Naini, in fact, added to the already existing theoretical explanation of this postulate, described by the way in details by the Shia scholars of the 8th and 9th centuries in their theoretical books like Kitab al-Imama. And these comments of Naini conclude that the Wilayat Faqih is an updated version of the idea of the Imama itself. The concept of the Islamic governance, Imama, and later Wilaya, is taken by Khomeini in order to defend his theory, which later became the dogmatic reason behind the Islamic revolution. The concept of governance in Shia Islam remains pivotal discourse within the religious and political establishment. It is of no lesser importance for the Sunnis as well, and the inability to find an answer to the question who has the right to rule and govern over Islamic Ummah led to the schism between the Shias and the Sunnis, one of the reasons for the schism. One of the groundbreaking postulates within the Shia Islam is the one of the supreme power in Islamic State. Defined with the Arabic term imama, it derives from the Arabic verb amma, to lead. The concept, which is later developed to its current levels and which is a matter of discussion, requires to look deeper into the historical discourse of the matter. The concept of governance, the leadership, initially emerges when the right of the descendants of Imam Ali had to be defended. It coincides with the struggle against the Umayyads and is represented in the commentaries to the Holy Quran, which became main ideological weapon to the adepts of Ali. For Shia Islam, which at its initial stage was a purely political movement, the necessity to defend the right of Shi'at al-Ali over the community is of an utmost importance. Main idea in this logical line of thought is the understanding among the Shia that their right on the throne derives from the divine guidance which is impersonated through the family of Ali, which are the bearers of the divine substance as well. This very idea stands at the bottom of the religious and political concept of the Shia. Later, the concept is further developed. The right of governance also stems from God and therefore is given only to the Shia. This idea opens the gates to the deification of Ali and his sons. With their sacrifice, the line of deification descends to the 12 Imams, therefore the divine substance of the Imama is defended. By the end of the 9th century, the initial phase of the formation of the Shia political and religious ideology is completed. For the ability of the Shia not only to survive, but also to expand their influence, we can judge by the establishment of various Shia states. The Zaydis in Yemen, the Fatimids in Egypt and Syria, the Hamdanis in Syria also, and the Buids in Iran and Iraq. Consequently, the Shia understanding of the supreme and just power found its perfect explanation. At certain point, the concept of what we today define as Wilayat Faqih starts to crystallize. The separation between clerical and secular power gradually became visible, yet there is an important detail. As the supreme authority has a divine essence, it is for the men of faith, or the clergy, to bear the responsibility of mediating between Imam al-Mahdi, the awaited Imam, and its congregation. This fact has played an important role in numerous occasions in strengthening the position of the clergy in its struggle against the Shah in Iran, for example, in its disputes against the clerical governance. The theory of Wilayat Faqih has been formulated and became also known as Al-Hukuma Islamiyah. Defined as a reformer by its followers, Imam Khomeini preached that Islamic governance is the personification of the divine just order, Amrullah, and is not similar to the monarchy nor to the governance of the Shah. The only just ruler is Allah. Contemporary adepts of the Wilayat Faqih do not separate between religion and politics, therefore introducing clergy to the realms of political realities. The 13 years Khomeini spent in exile in Iraq, shrine city of Najaf, is still a little known page of his life. His leadership practices were a mirror of his position in-betweenness, characterized by his physical presence in Najaf and his continued attachment to the home to Iran. The social dynamics at work inside the Iraqi seminaries are also explored first to situate Khomeini in his place of exile. While he was kept at a distance by Najaf's most influential clerical groups, he also had access to a social base of his own, a group of supporters composed mainly of Iranian students and low-ranking scholars. His scholarly and social activities among Najaf's community of learning allowed him to consolidate and spread his religious influence. His political activities were less overt than generally assumed. He kept a low profile in Najaf's public sphere, yet he maintained a political presence transnationally through his network. At its end, the traditionalists in Najaf declined the possibility of acknowledging and adopting wilaya as an applicable from political point of view concept. They stood firm in their understanding that the clergy should remain neutral towards daily political battles, therefore preparing itself to meet the judgment day and in the meanwhile to protect religious and spiritual well-being of the usual people. Najaf remained loyal to Wilayat Hassa, which drew the line of difference between Najaf and Qom, and remains actual today as well. Iranian attempts, nevertheless, to conquer Iraqi Shias and subsequently to spread its influence among the Shia community worldwide remains intact. And if as I said, if in 2003 Iran proved to be rather unprepared to bear the responsibility of tackling with the unexpected gift which the US-led invasion served in front of Tehran by toppling Saddam Hussein. In 2014, Tehran was rather vigilant and with a strategy how to exert its comprehensive control over Iraqi political security and religious environment. Since June 9th, Iran progressively expanded its influence, if not even control over Iraq, as Baghdad struggled and keeps struggling to contain the effect of the presence of the Islamic State. As it's been told earlier, Iran unexpectedly received a less anticipated gift from the U.S. administration of President Bush. On the face of it, there should not be a problem. More than half of the Iraqi population of 35 million is Shia. They both detest and fear ISIS and its Sunni jihadists, who have proclaimed the Islamic caliphate in northern Iraq. And yet, Iran is facing certain issues, certain problems and obstacles, which we will discuss in conclusion. Despite the threat which comes from ISIS, the religious rivalry between Iraq, the Iraqi and the Iranian Shias, is continuing. While Qom acknowledges Najaf's supreme role in Iraq, it also understands that the question who will inherit Sistani's mantle remains very important. Najaf itself have struggled for its importance since the revolution of 1921 and is ever since in special relations with both Baghdad and Qom. The city suffered enormous losses during Saddam Hussein's rule, and only after 2003 it began restoring its clout. After 2005 and the new constitution, which has been widely supported by the Hausa, Najaf managed to regain its importance. The role of the Shia component in Iraqi political life added to the importance of the Hausa and allowed it to contain the growing Iranian influence. It's been reminded to the Iranian emissaries that the loyalty of the Iraqi Shias lies with the Sistani, and this is a major obstacle in front of Tehran. To repeat, the office of Ali Khamenei is very much aware that the battle for Najaf is not only for the Shia community, but is also for the souls of more than 150 million Shias worldwide. Sistani has followed with more followers than Khamenei. Born Iranian, he has never linked himself with the Iranian regime, nor ever followed the concept of wilaya. Lately, Iran is promoting his candidate, a Najafi-born Hashimi Shahroudi, to replace Sistani, a move that would give Tehran an immensely powerful platform to influence Iraqi Shia. Shahroudi is a pious follower of Khomeini, a senior member of the hardline clerical hierarchy that rules Iran, and a former judiciary chief with a brutal, as it's been defined by some people, brutal record against opponents of the Tehran regime. He played a vital role in political battle against former president Mohammad Khatami. It remains curious to discuss the issue of the inheritance. And that's what I would like to conclude, just to have the opportunity, the time to move on Lebanon. The issue of inheritance today is a topic which is widely discussed in Najaf. It remains unclear yet who would be the one who would be appointed by Sistani, as it happened between him and his predecessor Abul Qasim al-Hui, who specifically noted to Ali al-Sistani as his successor. And as we all know, Ali Sistani was the one who was attending the not only the funeral of the Grand Ayatollah al-Hui, but also was the one who was preaching during the ceremony.
And he also allowed him to teach a few classes instead of him. It's like a sign.
The difference, though, when it comes to Sistani, is the fact that Sistani has a few disciples and few students. He's not known widely for his activities as in teaching. Which really opens the space for speculation. Who would be the one who would replace him? As I mentioned, we have certain evidences that are showing that the Iranians are growing their presence in not only politically in Iraq, but specifically in Najaf by increasing the number of real estate which is personally owned by Iran. But it is also known that Shahroudi opened his own office in Najaf, which led consequently to the announcement of the four existing offices by Bashir al-Najafi, Mohammed al-Hakim, Ali al-Sistani, and Ishaq al-Fayyad, reminding the students studying in Najaf not to accept the usual in Najaf monthly payments of a fee of a scholarship, which Shahrudi is presenting. Okay. Also,
which means not to study not with him, yeah, or under him.
Yes. Also,
be tempted with the money that he actually.
Sure. Yeah. Money works.
Scholars in Najaf accept
Say
also
it again.
There are enough scholars in Najaf, well-based scholars, except Shahrudi, and they are just waiting in line.
Sure.
Well, also on in few occasions, Sistani reminded to his colleague, if we can say so, Khamenei, where he stands in a conversation with the son of Grand Ayatollah Sistani, Mohammed Rida. I was told that, for example, the Ayatollah is already avoiding climbing up at the rooftop of his house, which is just 50 meters away of Imam Ali Shrine, because he is not willing to be seen by as I was told by the Iranian not spies but those who are watching.
Why he's afraid
because
for his life?
No, he's not afraid, but he's just feeling uncomfortable as his office appears to be surrounded by already a state owned by Iran. Also, in the verge of the crisis of 2014 and 15, when especially in 14, when the government of Abadi was negotiated, an emissary was sent by Tehran to seek the advice of Grand Ayatollah about who shall assume the post of the prime minister. The emissary has been kept for 3 days in the in Najaf before being received by Sistani, and in this very short meeting, which literally took no more than 10 minutes, the Grand Ayatollah pronounced his very important sentence that it's a time for Iraq to witness a change. The emissary then went back to Tehran, conveying the message to Ali al-Khamenei, and Khamenei then announced publicly, saying that if this is what the Grand Ayatollah wants, then it's not for Iran to impose any decisions over Iraq. Lately, Qasem Soleimani, the notorious General Soleimani, was also seeking an audience with Sistani, and it's being actually refused, although he had waited also a couple of days in Najaf. Instigated by the office of Sistani, we saw, fortunately we are not witnessing it today, but we saw also certain bold moves out of Abadi, the Prime Minister Abadi, who in one particular occasion during a meeting, an internal meeting of the National Alliance, the alliance which unifies all Shia political parties and is led by Ibrahim al-Jafari, he challenged the presence of Qasem Soleimani and asked him to leave. Also, during the
impolite, in a very impolite way.
Yes. Also, as a last example, before just moving to Lebanon, during the invasion, during the operation against the Crete, we have seen a lot of evidences of graffitis wrote across the city praising Qasem Soleimani and praising the role of Khamenei. Later on, we have seen a reminder from of Prime Minister Abadi to his Iranian counterparts asking them to act in more modest way and not to offend the people of Iraq, as such graffitis are in contradiction of the political and social environment in the country. Lastly, the Iranian presence has been witnessed by the posters of Khamenei being seen alongside with the posters of Sistani, and then we have seen these signatures where Iraq is in a very nice, polite way, were reminding the Iranians by using this verse that, "Oh, you stranger, when you are in the land
of a host,
behave." Having said that, I would like to conclude that as the battle of Fallujah emerges today, the most important one will be inevitably the one for Najaf. Who will take over Najaf is a matter of a discussion, and we shall not be certain what will be the outcome of this competition. It is important to mention that most probably I have little doubts that the next one to succeed Sistani in line will be one of the three Ayatollahs. Most probably that would be Muhammad al-Hakim, who holds the highest religious rank among the al-Hakim family in Iraq, who is cousin of Amar al-Hakim, also the head of the Supreme Islamic Council, ISKI. But the question is not who will immediately succeed Sistani, the question is who will come afterwards. Mm. The problem in Najaf is
the generation is over.
Yes, the problem. Yes, the problem as we see it today in Iraq is that Najaf did not act wisely enough, although I'm not the one to really estimate what Najaf does, but what people are saying, especially close to the al-Hakim al-Khoi families, they're saying that unfortunately we have no a certain figure which will come and may replace the Sistani and his closest allies, the three other Ayatollahs. When it comes to Lebanon, I without me being a particular specialist on Lebanon, I would like to say that this was widely discussed, by the way, in an interaction with the family of Jumblat. Even today, a couple of decades after the establishment of Hezbollah, the Shia Lebanese community is experiencing a very serious internal dispute. As it has been described to me, Hezbollah is a foreign body to the
entity.
Shia community. If we look at the profile of the big Shia families, clerical families, we would see inevitably their relation to Najaf. Unfortunately, within the last couple of decades, to my knowledge and to the extent of what I've been told, not a single high-ranked clerical representative who is not allied with Hezbollah has ever been allowed to go to Najaf. That means that with the Iranian consent, Hezbollah is trying to change the profile of the Shia community in Lebanon, therefore turning it into a related to the concept of wilaya and what wilaya itself represents as a political and religious dogma in Iran. to what extent that would be a successful strategy, it is really hard to say. I tend to believe and I tend to be optimistic that these social family contacts which are still in place between the Lebanese Shia community and Najaf are still intact to a large extent and will help the Shia community in Lebanon to strengthen its ability to confront that attempt, which I mean, I'm sure that you understand better than anyone else, which attempt is a very, very persistent coming from Hezbollah and from Iran. Yet the future of the Lebanese Shia community, as well as the future of the Shia community world across the Middle East, really depends by the result of the battle for Najaf, as I am taking the liberty to describe it. We certainly the Shia community in Lebanon certainly experienced these backlashes, losing its natural leaders, and now when it comes to a naturally born leader, we probably widely can recognize only Sheikh Hassan Nasrallah, whom I would challenge to what extent he is actually a pure religious leader and not a more political one. I think the process of changing the profile of the community in Lebanon is in place. The severe crisis in Syria is also helping in this rather negative process, as it's allowing Hezbollah to advocate for its own importance. And given the essence of the Lebanese political life, it's more or less now focused on different aspects than really taking care of the existence and the well-being of any of the communities, particularly the Shia one. I can assure you that the turbulences within the Druze community are of a very large scale, and looking at I will speculate now, for which I would like to excuse me, but if we are looking at Sistani, then if we look at what happens inside in Lebanon and what we see in the Druze community in Lebanon with Jumblat, I think we are facing a problem of the political inheritance. We don't know what will come after. We know what was before, but what will come after is a matter of a discussion which remains open, and I will be glad to discuss it with you if you have any questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Miroslav. This was quite a tour d'horizon, tour de force, tour de distance, tour de that. A lot. You covered a lot of territory. What?
Tour de France.
Tour de France? Not yet. But ISIS will get to France. Don't worry. Daesh will get to France.
Roland-Garros.
As they got there, actually. We are approaching the Q&A part. Questions to Miroslav. We should three questions and then answer them.
Of course.
And then we should go next. Yes. Your name?
Sarafim.
Again?
Sarafim. I'm a student.
Student is good.
It's good.
Okay, Sarafim, please.
Yeah, first year, no importance.
Student is great.
Mentioning Misral as a political person and getting back to Iraq, I wanted to ask, because it wasn't addressed, the. From unfortunately unconfirmed sources that say that there was an instruction from Khamenei himself to Nasrallah to try to make amends between Muqtada al-Sadr and the current Prime Minister of Iraq, I think?
Abadi.
And I wanted to ask what, except for the, you know, purely expanded the influence in Iraq, how, what strategic dividends or whatever, what interest has Iran in such making amends of trying to
mediate?
To consolidate the Iraqi Shia community?
Between the
Muqtada
Sadr and Prime Minister and the opposition led by
between Muqtada Sadr and Abadi.
It's only one part of the opposition. There are many others. Thank you, Serafim. Yes, your name, please.
Len Siegel. I wish I was a student because
you could always be.
I wish I could return to being a student. Actually, in the 2000s, I was director of psychological warfare operations in Iraq in Baghdad. So I ran psychological warfare there. And I wish I was a student because we didn't actually know what we were doing. We were just reacting.
When was that again?
2004 to 2010. I was in Baghdad for 6 years.
Okay.
Green Zone and Camp Victory, Camp Slayer, the usual IOTF operation. So my question actually is, could we never understood? Now's my opportunity to ask an expert to try and understand. And which actually also does relate to Muqtada al-Sadr or Jassi al-Mahdi, is that one is a militia, which was, we looked at it as a militia, which was very concerned with this community-based.
Sadr.
Yes.
Okay.
And on the other side was the Sunni, Al-Qaeda, which actually started in 1979, Al-Qaeda between the two rivers, and metamorphosed itself to what we call Daesh, or Islamic State today. And is a question which I found very, very interesting, because you have put together both Lebanon, together with the situation in Iraq.
Yeah.
Now, Lebanon we do understand, but Iraq we don't understand.
I'm glad that you understand Lebanon. Maybe you would explain to me.
Speak
then.
For yourself. I understand Iraq. I don't understand Lebanon.
It's a proxy to many issues coming out of a political, like you said, as well as a political.
Yeah.
This is coming out of Tehran. It's a political issue very much so. And it's intervention in Lebanon, it's intervention in Israel, it's intervention now in Syria. So it's very, very clear how proxy-orientated it is. But it was established also with something more than being political. It was established as being education, health, welfare, and so forth, a fully fledged entity. But the one thing which we never understood was in 2007, for example, the Muqtada basically decided that he wasn't holy enough, knowledgeable enough, and he stopped the war against Al-Qaeda or the Sunni Triangle. He went back to learn. And this gave David Petraeus the opportunity to say that his surge claimed victory.
Yeah.
And coming to this is exactly your lecture. We never understood how a leader of a militia so concerned with his community at the height of a war could say, I'd like to have a time out and go study Najaf.
He was a sabbatical.
Well, sabbatical,
yeah. 6 years in politics.
It's a holy of holies.
It's a holy of holies, yeah. Now, this actually then gave opportunity in the Sunni Triangle.
Yeah.
And this is still the Sunni Triangle. The Shia will never come into this. The Sunni Triangle, take it or leave it. This was the Ba'ath Party, which ironically was 163% Shia when it was established in 1963. But the question is, linking the two together, of Lebanon and Iraq, where it's very clear what's happening with Hezbollah and its proxy. What we don't understand is how leaders can actually take sabbaticals from the religious aspect. Do they have a long-term vision?
Like Sadr-ing me?
Like Sadr. You know, how come the entire organization, it wasn't just him, Jassi al-Mahdi, basically stopped fighting for 18 months and let everything just happen? It wasn't anything, you know, and they weren't concerned about it. So this is, as you say, the separation between the secular and religious.
Okay.
And the second question, obviously, is that because I've now mentioned where the Sunni Triangle is, Iran has total supreme control of the Basra, for example.
Of what?
Basra. There's no dispute. This is a Shia area. This is next to Iran. Any import and export out of Basra goes through Tehran ministries and so forth. So where actually then in Iraq, for example, are we going to be seeing this conflict on a daily basis? Is this going to be still Baghdad,
mm-hmm.
as it always was? Are we going to see the Shiite trying to take the Sunni triangle, convert military tech? And would a Kurdistan actually emerge as independent in any way?
So if I understand correctly, if you're asking whether the Shia, the Iran would take the south and
they have the south already metaphorically, and there's no Sunni against them down there, and there's
yeah.
no Kurdish population. Whatever.
And natural causes.
But would we see a Kurdistan emerging out of this?
Like an independent state?
Well, we're not independent because it's transnational, but will we see actually the Kurds becoming more dominant as opposed to Shia, or would we actually see a Shia attempt the same way as Daesh is trying to take the Kurdish area? Do we see...
But you're also talking about the Sunni area. They might kick out all the Sunnis or do whatever and take over there.
Yes.
That's another part
of
the question.
But this is actually part of the question. You know, if the Justin Martin is taking an 18-month sabbatical, are they content to having the Sunni area still being the Sunni triangle, or
yeah.
do they actually want everybody to convert to the Sunni triangle or not? I mean, it's
convert or leave.
Well, this is Daesh's policy.
Yeah, I mean, it's a question.
This is the Quran. You have three options: convert, pay, or die.
Yeah.
Okay.
Both questions I see very much focused on Sadr, and I think Muqtada will be very happy to know that he is again into the eye of the interest even in Israel.
He's all over Twitter.
He's all over, yeah. Now the reason why. I will give you an example. In the recent battles, let's say end of 2014 and the entire 15, we have seen a lot of examples of Hezbollah, the Lebanese Hezbollah, conducting operations in Iraq under the supervision of Iran.
In 2014?
14-15, yeah. Why? Not because Iran is not capable, or the big militias run by the Iranians, like Qatayb, Hezbollah of Abu al-Mahdi al-Muhandis, or Badr of Hadi al-Amri, are not capable. But as I was told by someone in Najaf, because the Iranians were very, very, very sensitive of not being seen on the ground. Not being blamed by the Iraqis and by the United States and by the international community, and especially by the Sunnis, who were fiercely fighting in north to be present in Iraq. So, who are we calling upon? We're calling upon our Arab brothers coming from Lebanon. We have many evidences of people. Like for example, I can give you a first-hand example. The son of Hadi al-Amri has been left Dubai, where he had a very lavish life for a very long time.
Hadi al-Amri is a commander of Badr, which
yeah.
is very pro-Iranian, strong,
yes.
Strong
they,
militia, very strong.
They, yeah.
Old too.
I can show you. You see that? Please.
He's a good-looking guy. Yes.
Look him up at the.
Google yeah. His son was sent on a training with Hezbollah. And then came back
to Lebanon.
To Lebanon, and then was sent on operations in Syria, and then was seen operating in Iraq.
Hmm.
Now, Sadr, as you have asked me, the problem of Sadr is that Sadr is seen, the Sadr family particularly, not Muqtada. We shall not think about Muqtada today as Muqtada himself, although he very much wants to be seen as Muqtada Sadr. But we shall think about his family and the legacy of his family, which is largely related to Lebanon also. There is no much of respect towards Sadr inside the high-ranked intellectual, religious circles in both Lebanon and in Iraq, we shall be very, very, very clear about it.
It's almost illiterate.
He does not belong to the elite. He also when we should take in consideration this, Sadr was not patient enough in 2003 not to commit a huge mistake confronting Sistani particularly by killing Abul Majid al-Khuy, the son of Abul Qasim. Who has come from London, where he was in exile after the events related to his father, and was slain to death in Najaf at Imam Ali Shrine. It's a huge crime, you know. In the mentality of the Shia people, it's really difficult to define and to explain. So ever since, the split between Sadr and Sistani is so enormous that Sadr barely goes to Najaf, although he resides in Kufa, which is just outside of Najaf.
It's actually a suburb of Najaf.
By the way, yes. It's really like a suburb today. But so he barely goes there. He himself and his emissaries, I have no record of them actually meeting Sistani or Mohammed Rida. Sometimes to meet Mohammed Rida, Sistani, the son, is almost equal to see the son, to see the father. So I have no track record about such thing for the last decades. I would speculate saying that the examples when the Iranians are particularly looking at Sadr are always an examples of something that Iran needs today to be tackled on a really up to date basis. Like there is no such a close interaction between now. Sadr taking a sabbatical, honestly, we shall remember, and I'm sure that since you've been there, you remember the operation which was handled by the
2008 in Basra.
Yeah,
by the
American forces, supported by Maliki and the Iraqi forces. It's been a clear operation against the strongholds of Maliki of Sadr. And Sadr,
in Basra,
by the way, then proved himself as a very incapable military leader. Mm-hmm. His army, Jaish al-Mahdi, after he announced the ceasefire, and by the way, Maliki was not alone within the Iraqi political spectrum, he was not alone in this decision to go straight against Sadr. If you remember, he was supported by the Fadila party, and also he was given a clearance from ISKI, from the at that time it was SKIRI, the Supreme Council of the Islamic Revolution. He was given a clear mandate: you go against Sadr, because Sadr is breaking the equation. Mm-hmm. And in Iraq, although it looks like really in a chaotic state, there is a very deep, well-established balance, which the political leaders of Iraq, by the way, both Sunnis and Shias, are very capable to maintain. Unfortunately, it's always for the harming the interest of the Iraqi nation as a nation, but it's really protecting their interests. So that was what happened with Jaish al-Mahdi. Now, the Jaish by itself ceased its existence. It was no more. We saw other groups emerging out of Jaish, which Asaib is the largest one. Mm-hmm. Asaib al-Ahl al-Haq, these are the now I'm in this academic audience, I would allow myself to really keep speculating. Asaib are led by Sheikh Azali, and it is known that the Sheikh never denounced his affiliation to Sistani. although he's largely seen as close to the to Iran. But this is an example, a very important point, which gives us an example of a really the real nature of the Iraqi society. While it may be seen getting close to Iran, as it happened in 2014, it will never betray, it may never betray the allegiance of its allegiance to Najaf, which is very, very important. And that's seen as a main obstacle for the Iranians, because the Iranians thought that inevitably they will enter, as they were asked by the Iraqi political elite to come and help. But then they suddenly found out that as the battle lines were strengthened enough and the counter offensive started, suddenly the Iraqis became a bit reluctant, you know, to wave the flags of the Iranians, you know, and to.
That's why Hezbollah is totally different.
Yeah, it is. So
yes, but they're also seen as Lebanese. They're Lebanese.
They
would like to sort of play down.
Yeah, that's
the dependence
that
on Iran. Yes, but you're right. They are much closer.
So
different circumstances between Lebanon and Iraq.
Yeah, these are pretty much.
Yes. But also the Shia in Iraq are from the 12.
Yes.
Oh, everybody.
They're all
the Yemenites.
No, this is where the actual tombs are.
No, but also in Qom you have, and in Mashhad you have.
Yeah, of course.
No, they're all 12ers. Only in Yemen you have different.
Yes.
Yeah, and the Ismaili community.
Ismaili, all over the world.
Yeah, they are the up to the 7th, and then but all of us are the 12ers. So it's not Sharia. So, yes. Yeah, good point. In this regard. I would argue, actually, to what extent Basra is fully under the Iranian control. It was that like that, and we have records of the British army officers acknowledging that once they invaded Basra in 2003, they found out a well-set Iranian presence there. But today, I would really argue.
But it's not under that.
You would argue again. I would argue
that Basra is not under the full control of Iraq.
Oh, really?
Not under control of Baghdad either. Baghdad does not control imports.
Well, in Iraq things are often are very relative. So let's say that relatively Basra is under the larger control of Baghdad than of Iran. Let's put it that way. And it's basically because of the corruption. Because Basra was kept as a place of reign for a very long time of Fadila. And we know that Fadila actually using their Iranian connections, by the way, with the glad the consent of the Iranians for the smuggling of oil. So
but that was also what Sadr was doing. Sadr also.
Well, apparently everyone is doing it in Iraq.
Everyone is doing because we need income in order to operate.
So I would be doubtful about comparing Basra with KRG. KRG, the issue of the Kurds, I'm sure that you can find a real experts on the Kurds, which I'm not. I can tell you of my experience of what I've seen with the Kurds. The Kurds really had these hard to resist notion of proclaiming their independence, but they kind of understood that they have very little number of friends across the region, if not in the worldwide, honestly. And being stranded between between Iran and Turkey, they have to be very, very careful. Barzani in 2014, I think it was July 18th, he went to Tehran begging the Iranians to help. And by the way, they did. Qasem came and helped.
To help in what way?
to defend against ISIL.
Qasem Soleimani, Qasem Soleimani is the commander of Jaish al-Quds, this Iranian unit,
foreign,
which is doing the operations abroad, outside of Iraq.
So, honestly, that really damaged the idea that this glory of invincibility of the Peshmergas. I believe in one thing that, and we have seen examples of this, before really focusing on Fallujah or Mosul, we have seen a major victory in Iraq, in the area of Tuz Hurmat, which actually broke the spine, between Mosul, Raqqa, Aleppo, which was the lifeline for Mosul, for ISIS. I'm sorry, the fact that Tuz Hurmat was taken by the American forces and by the by the Peshmergas, enraged the Shia militias, and there were many clashes. There were events of many clashes when the Shia militias were pushing against the Peshmergas to kick them out of this area, which is, by the way, inhabited by Shia Turkomans. But the fact is that now we have no. We were discussing this last week. There are no good people and good guys and bad guys in Iraq. Everyone plays a very dirty role. What we were largely discussing the example of Diyala and the social experiment which has happened there by
Diyala.
Diyala. Oh,
no, Diyala is east of Baghdad, on the Iranian border.
Yeah, no, Diyala Anbar, we negotiated with the tribes.
But the fact is Anbar is 98% Sunni, while Diyala was a mixed area, which...
Baghdad.
Yes, which lately witnessed an attempt to be converted into a purely Shia, which has happened, the same thing has happened up north by the Kurds. And if you notice, 2 days ago, the governor of Kirkuk is advocating, it's like testing the possibility of turning Kirkuk in an autonomous area, which is really damaging proposal at this very moment in Iraq, because Iraq is shall we wonder how difficult is the situation in Iraq?
So how did the Kurds lose the international support? Because after the 1991 war, they had total international support, including the no-fly zone, and this was a major influence by Kurdish expats in London, Paris, and Washington for the 2003 war. Somehow they've lost all of that.
Nobody recognized them as a state even then.
But they had support.
I would protect.
At that time they were in front of Saddam Hussein. Now they are not.
I would actually differentiate between having an international sympathy and international support. Then they had a sympathy, which led to the resolution of the UN for establishing a no-fly zone. But that was a sympathy. That was not a support. The support which the Kurds witnessed is now by the American forces and by everyone. But
you mean military support?
Yeah, military support.
No, there is also investment in the Kurdish area.
That's Turkey, mostly Turkey.
The investments are coming from everywhere. South Korea.
That was an agreement.
That came as an agreement with Baghdad. The issue of Kurdistan has never been a resolved one, and at certain points the relations between Erbil and Baghdad became so tense that Abadi was not in possession of the phone number of Nechervan Barzani, the prime minister. He had no his phone, and then we were told by Barzani that.
Not even a cell phone?
No, he was told, no, not at all.
Was it your wall?
He was told that, we were told by Nechervan that that on certain occasion Abadi was calling him, and Nechervan assumed that that might be probably the prime minister, and he was wondering whether to answer the phone. So they were really in a bad relations, and these relations are not getting.
Had the telephone of Barzani.
I hope so.
Yeah, because they are both Kurds.
Hope so. So, so that is a thing which is not solved. It's still there, and I hope that no sudden moves will happen anyway. Because
next question, Ronan.
Referring to the main topic of the lecture, which is the whatever will happen in Najaf, I don't think that you are not expecting Najaf to change clothes and to suddenly, I don't know, maybe in the next generation of scholars to adopt Wilayat al-Faqih. I agree with you. I think that Najaf is specialized in not doing that. It's being unique for resisting Wilayat al-Faqih and would continue. You don't really change jerseys so easily. And that could be the case with Wilayat al-Faqih. Maybe the Manjaiya is in a kind of a historic decline because it
in Najaf
the Manjaiya it constantly refuses to be directly involved in politics. They constantly do things behind the scenes. There is a very, very negative image of politicking and being engaged in politics, which some of my colleagues heard from the senior Ayatollahs in Najaf. They don't really like doing that. When, if you remember, you probably remember better than I, in 2014, during the election campaign, which ended up with Maliki winning, Bashir al-Najafi was on television saying that you don't vote for Maliki, don't vote al-Dawlat al-Kanun, vote for Iski, for Omar al-Kanun. It was very, very, very bad, and it harmed him. And I think it also minimized his chances of ever succeeding Sistani, if he had chances at all. It looked like a buffoon doing that, like a clown, you know. And the fact that they refuse to do that out of a certain moral stance or something like this means that in a very politicized society and country like Iraq, they are losing ground. Even Muqtada Sadrwi is not that reluctant to be in politics.
He's not an Ayatollah.
He's not an Ayatollah.
He's not an Ayatollah.
And he's behaving as if he was the well-known pattern of a spiritual authority behind the scenes.
Yeah, but Sadr is sending Sadr has no problem with Wilaya. Muqtada has no problem with Wilaya.
Yeah, so maybe
his marja is in Iran.
Yeah, but you don't expect him to succeed the current generation of scholars in Najaf. So unless Sadr is taking over Najaf by one sort of an apocalyptic, I don't know, Najaf, the Marjaiya in Najaf would continue to be what it is, even if somebody else would be there, or younger person, possibly for you.
So what's the question?
No, it's more like a comment. If you expect that that Najaf would ever change,
do you agree that Najaf is declining?
Yeah.
That's really the question.
Then, or with my comment,
I would as much as I love Najaf, I would love to see it stable, and I don't.
You would love to what?
Najaf.
To see it stable.
Yeah, to see it stable, and it's powerful enough. The fact that, as by the way, we were kind of arguing with Jumblat about it, and he said, and I told him that why are you allowing to see what is happening to what is happening in Lebanon? He said, but you shall not forget we have no Najaf in Lebanon. So Najaf is, as some people were like metaphorically saying, it's like Rome.
Mm. You don't, the Vatican.
Yes, exactly. That's the. I wish to believe that this is it. My real concern though is, is not about Najaf itself, but it's about the ability of the Shia community to stay together. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, Fallujah will fall with the cost of immense destruction and victims. That's, but whether the Shia community will remain to united in Iraq, it's a different question, because we already know that Al-Amri, who split from
Hadi Al-Amri, is the leader of Badr again, this powerful militia, very pro-Iranian.
Yeah, he was the offset of Al-Quds forces in Iraq. So he blames Abadi for everything. Amar al-Hakim, yesterday we saw him wearing uniform.
Really?
Yeah, going to Fallujah to a meeting with Al-Amri and Abu al-Mahdi. So I'm a bit concerned about this thing, not about Najaf itself. Because Najaf so far is quiet. It's not saying, they are saying that the things in Iraq are not still yet at the edge. So we have, you may wait a bit. Probably that could be a very illusive assumption. So that's what I'm really afraid of.
Does Amar al-Hakim, Iski, do they have a militia of their own?
Yeah, of course they all
do.
They all have.
So what, you see him getting close again to Badr?
I don't know.
I don't think they're united at all.
No,
between us.
No, it's it could
Badr
be.
Badr and Assad went with Maliki.
It could be an
away.
It could, yeah, of course. It could be an alliance of convenience. It's not necessarily that they will.
Everyone wants to have part of the cake of liberating Fallujah, and the Hashid and all those militias.
Yeah, but Hashid will not be allowed.
They will not be allowed.
But they were calling for that. I mean, for at least a year now. They were calling, and then the army in Abadi said, no, we take Ramadi first, no, we take other places first. And now...
I don't believe that... And Abadi understands this. We saw it today in the media outlets that he issued a verdict calling for an arrest of any militia member who is seen fighting inside Fallujah.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. He's trying to keep them.
Let me just explain. Sure. This is the greatest fear of the Sunnis of Fallujah, Mosul, and so on, because they're afraid the Shi'i militias will slaughter them once they liberate
which
them.
Which they will do,
you know, which they did a little bit, not so much, but they did already.
But let's not let's face it. I mean, even Mukafahat al-Irhab, the counter-terrorism and the Shurta, we are engaged in the fighting, while also infiltrated by members of the militia.
Yes, but they are more under the command of the military, after all.
Yeah,
I mean,
they are
you
soldiers.
Are right. Yes.
They are soldiers.
The military is mostly Shia. Okay.
There's much more logic to use the Hashid or the Shiite militia in the region that there are some proximity with the Peshmerga. It is much more useful in the region of Tuskarmantu and other regions that are two militias.
But they are sometimes fighting each other too.
Yeah.
If there is
the Kurdish and the Shia are fighting each other. So that's another problem.
Except that not respecting the status quo, this is the Kurdish Peshmerga. They are trying to solve the disputed areas by having presence there. They already did that.
Can I ask a question?
Yes,
please.
You said earlier that you would challenge Sheikh Sayyid Hassan Nasrullah to be a religious leader. What do you mean by that?
You have to though excuse my ignorance on, like, specifically on Lebanon. I would, due to his allegiance to Wilayah, I think he turned to be more political than religious. But again, that's an issue which I would argue with you without me actually winning in this argument. I mean, the
no, because in Islam it gathers everything. It gathers politics.
Yes,
everything.
That's true. But you know, when you come to the practical terms, like really, like up to date, what happens today? You're right. I mean, We can even challenge if Sistani is not very much politically active, because I can give you many examples of him.
No,
but with Hassan Nasrallah, but you think, I mean, if you take the how we judge about Hassan's Hassan Nasrallah's standings, it's based on his public appearances and speeches. Where, trust me, everyone is following them. Like, I've seen people in Kuwait gathering around the big TVs following Hassan Nasrallah while there was a game in Champions League, and they were preferring to actually listen because it's more important for them. And out of these speeches, 85% is a political talk. It's about, which is very well disguised with the religious terms, you know, the divine right of the obligation of fighting for the Palestinian cause, you know, which cause? I mean, the Palestinian cause of whom? Of Hamas or PA? So that's, you know, but he's very persuasive in terms of using religious terms in serving his political causes. That's my understanding, but I don't want to claim anything more than that, because I don't want to be to earn
but
enemies among Hezbollah.
That is incapable.
Say that again.
But that doesn't mean that he's incapable.
No.
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 Because
I see him as a very powerful and unlike the other leaders, I think that he can do both.
Yes, of course.
But he's a very junior
cleric.
He doesn't mean that he cannot serve also as a cleric, but he's very junior.
Yeah, no.
And in Shia, this is
he himself
important.
Has a marja. He's not a source of emulation. He has a source of
emulation. Was under Fadlallah.
Yeah. So it's we shall not forget in favor of what you're saying. He is the head of both political and military wings of Hamas, of Hezbollah, and for many years he has been very successful, even with the support of Iran, of course. What can you do? But to the extreme that he actually first sustained the position of Hezbollah after the withdrawal of the Syrians in 2005. Then 2006, he claimed victory over Israel, who, by the way, probably is the only one who can say that I was successfully challenging the Israel military force.
Mike.
Yes, in the Middle East. Who can say that?
Hamas also says that, but depends how
yes.
you...
Yes.
Yeah.
while they're sitting in Doha, of course, of course. That's
Egyptian force also says that after the Obur.
I think
no, there's no reason to doubt him.
I think Nasrallah's problem.
No, because when he says that I would challenge him, it means that he doubts.
No, but the question is, do you see him more as an Ayatollah, which he's not, by the way, or as a political military leader? That's the question.
Yeah.
Where is the balance? Not that he's neither, nor.
Going back to where
he
is.
He is more political than military.
Well, it depends really.
And
where
he has an aura. He has an aura of a man of cloth, of a religious leader, yes. But it's not the same like Khamenei.
No.
But the truth
it's
is
not the same like.
The truth with Nasrallah is that he is a military leader.
Yes.
And nobody can challenge today Hezbollah in Lebanon. That's why.
No.
And political. And
that's
political.
Why he's there.
I think the question is, does Nasrallah lead his people by virtue of their respect for him, his military political might, or by virtue of the fact that he is the head of the community?
No, he's not the
he's
head,
not
of,
the head
community.
Of the community.
But who is that? In other words...
The heads of the communities are those coming from the traditional Lebanese families, like the Sharaf al-Din, for example.
But
these
you
are
say
the
same about Iraq, that you have 150 tribes.
Yes.
And the 150 tribes are the true leaders, and it is...
Are the sheikhs.
Sheikhs.
Yes, but the
and
sheikhs...
And how they relate either
oh,
to...
Oh, I'll tell you. When in 2014 the Sistani issued the fatwa, then the attack against Samarra started. There were dozens of sheikhs who went to Sistani and asked him to give them the clearance to march to Samarra and defend. And he said, no, you stay here and stay where you are and don't do anything. And they listened to him, which is a bit different, you know, really.
So in both cases, if you take it back to the question of where is Tehran, you'll find that the head of the clans, the head of the tribes, actually are on the ground.
Yes.
And what is happening is you have an intervention who's trying to, but not successful, because we're talking now decades.
Yeah, but Iranian society is not a tribal society.
Well, it's a dumb destroy that.
The Iranian, not the Iraqi.
So weakened it.
The Iraqi society today is a very much tribally influenced based.
Yeah, like the families of Lebanon. So when you say,
but the families in Lebanon are political families. They are not tribal families. Then there is not this. There is not the thing of the of. Well, you're really getting into this slope.
Deep water.
Yeah, it's a bit difficult. I mean, because in Iraq, you have, like, let's take the huge congregation of Jabur, which are Sunni Shia, both. They're like a huge clan, but they have north a Sunni, down a Shia. And they know where they stand. They know that, anyhow we belong to Jabur. But then comes, but now we are we Shia Sunni? Which, in terms of, for example, Fallujah today, they are kind of, this is very important. There's tribal allegiance who belongs to.
Well, I'll help you, because in Lebanon, Hezbollah are actually in the bad parts, and the good parts are not controlled by Hezbollah, even in southern Lebanon. Hezbollah does not control Majnun, for example, but Majnun is within territory that is under Hezbollah control, but it's not Hezbollah and Majnun.
Okay.
And I'd say the same actually about Iraq, that your militias are coming into areas which are controlled by the tribal leaders, but essentially they don't have control of them.
But the militias are also the content of the they're conscripted by tribal members.
Not by force.
No.
The conscripts would go anywhere else.
No. We had stronger force. We were actually. We have seen and suffering the consequences of the foe of the Iraqi army. When you saw hundreds of soldiers running away from as soldiers, and the very next day they assign as militia leaders, going back to those same areas where they kind of deserted, fighting fiercely. But with under the flags of Sarat Abbas, Sarat Salam.
Yeah, they changed the
There's a lot of voluntary element in joining the militia.
Yeah, it's like really
kind of a force. You know.
Now the question is, what in this case, what are you defending? You're defending your tribal militia flag, or you defend Iraq?
Well, that's the question of southern Lebanon. Hezbollah has southern Lebanon,
but it does not
have the town, the city of Majnun.
And
the conclusion is that everything is temporary, everything is relative, tomorrow can change, and don't intervene military in any other country like the United States.
Okay,
thank you very much.
Wonderful definition. Very, very realistic. You have this and you have that, you have a choice, always a choice.
You know that.
You have options. You live in options all the time.
On the 100th anniversary of Sykes-Picot, just the assumption is just leave it as it is, you know. Don't
maybe it's better than that.
Maybe I can tell you something to end, which is will be interesting for you, but for everybody here, I believe. I was teaching American officers, many of them who had stayed in Iraq for 2 years and then came back to America for another course, and whatever. So some of them were intelligence officers, and after 2008, they took many prisoners from Jaish al-Mahdi, from Muqtada Sadr's people, into custody, and they interrogated them. They couldn't speak a word of Arabic, but they had good translators, mostly translators were Lebanese. And they asked the simple soldiers, who is your marja? Who is your marja? That's a question. Iraqis, okay, Shia, south. Everybody said Sistani, he is our marja. That's good. So they asked them, don't you know that Sistani said, don't fight the Americans? Don't you know that? Which he did. They said, oh, of course we know. So why were you fighting us? And they said, because we were told by our own mullahs that Sistani cannot say fight the Americans, because the Americans will level Najaf. So it was taqiyya, it was a precautionary simulation. So he says, don't fight the Americans. Don't fight the Americans. So we do this, and he says that, and that was it. There you are.
The Berlin Museum. The Berlin Museum. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yes, guys, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Miroslav Zafirov, thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.
Wonderful afternoon. Wonderful afternoon. Thank you so much.
Miro, you know that in the recent fighting in Fallujah, one of the militias was waving the picture of Sheikh Nimer al-Nimer, which created a diplomatic scandal with Saudi Arabia. Then Abedi had to meet the Saudi ambassador.
Tell me about it later. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Join us.
To say that, to apologize for the accession.
It was not a forceful one.
שבבים המיליציות האלה.
רגע, רגע, מי זה נימר נימר תזכיר לי?
זה השייח השני הזה במזרח סעודיה, שהסעודים הפרידו לו, עשו לו ניתוח להפרדת הראש.
בין הראש ובין הזה?
בין הראש ובין
הזה. אז רגע, ספר לי מה הסיפור.
לא שרדת לי.
אני זוכר שכן. מה אני? לא, לא שרדת. לא, 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 לא. קומן שלא. זה קשה.
זה חבר זרה.
כן, זה לא. אבל מה הסיפור?
אחת המיליציות הקרובות האלה החלוג'ה עכשיו, היא שימשה בתמונה שלו, ראו אותה
מיליציה שלו.
לא זוכר איזה מיליציה, איך מלא מיליציות, מלא מיליציות, זה באמת...